It's Such a Beautiful Day is a movie that I do not think I will ever forget. The usage of simple animation with stick figures was able to make me feel emotions of sadness, disgust, dread, humor, and appreciation in such a short amount of time. A character study to show that the small things in life are all we have sometimes. At the end of the day, I am not a professional video essayist, if that's a thing. This piece of work has so many layers that I think you should experience on your own. I'm a huge proponent of everyone having their own interpretation of an art, and I think this is a prime example of that. And this is how I believe the movie was meant to be. With that being said, thank you so much for watching, and I really hope you enjoy this. The picture opens with our protagonist, Bill. Bill is not really an individual of note, a feeling known too well for some. He lives in his apartment, putting the same keys on the same spot of his counter every day, following the same mundane tasks he will do tomorrow. As the story goes, you begin to realize that we only see things through Bill's eyes, his desires, stories, observations, and fears. In the first chapter, everything will be okay. Bill begins to wonder about whether the daily routine of his life is all that it is. Is straying away from his everyday tasks considered abnormal? We learn that Bill has been receiving treatment for an unnamed condition, and he is beginning to experience memory loss due to this. It's fair to say that he is developing dementia at a steady rate. This is seen through the film as he begins to forget small things and begins to lose sense of reality as he hallucinates people with misshapen forms and has difficulty understanding communication. Facing the fear of his symptoms, he wonders if memories remain alive in the brain after death or are erased as soon as the body fails. According to Bill, that's all we are. We're merely brains taking refuge in our shelter of meat and bone, afraid of change, decisions, and pain. Although Bill thinks about these things, it still really troubles him to hear that his treatment is not working. Bill continues to take note of the small things he notices in life, especially being delighted by the message "I love you" being etched in the sand as he walks along the beach. With his physical health beginning to fade, his mother comes to aid him. A scene is shown of Bill's mother grabbing a pair of scissors to remove a piece of loose thread on the back of his shirt. Bill slaps the scissors out of her hand as his mother, shaken to the core, asks if he truly thought she meant to harm him. Bill only thinks that she's beginning to look old. This situation highlighting the beginning of disconnection between Bill and his loved ones due to his battle with this condition. As Bill's health takes a massive dip, he becomes enraged with the fact that he can't find a way to escape this empty void of thought. He's beginning to feel the life he once knew slip away. Bill falls unconscious, only to wake up a few days later in the hospital with days of both positive and negative recovery. After a couple of days, he finds himself to feel just fine when he sees his mother and uncle speaking to the doctor. They seem upset, nearly irritated, not because of Bill's condition, but to change their plans as they believed he would pass away. The disconnect between not only his loved ones begins to expand furthermore, but with himself as well. In chapter 2, we learn history of Bill's family. As a child, his half-brother Randall was out on the seaside looking at the waves. Being limited by his physical limitations, he lived a life of not being able to do much. He spotted a seagull he seemed to love so much and ran towards the sun as he greatly desired to become closer with it. With this, he ran only to be swallowed by the deep blue ocean. His final thoughts being the moment of pure desire that he was always limited to in his life. With his passing, Bill's mother became grief-stricken and paranoid by making Bill wear protective equipment everywhere he went. His mother wore layers of grief and turmoil, though her humanity still shined through in moments as she would leave notes in his lunchbox for school. Through all of this, his father left them, which caused his mother to spiral, and this caused Bill to feel pretty lost. Stories date back further, ranging from Bill's grandmother suffering from dementia and a tumor in her brain for her to claim it was a fish in her head, to his great-great-uncle being a wild man living in the woods to die there being one with nature. Through these stories, we are brought back to present time with Bill being back at his job. After having a conversation with his coworker, who watched a documentary about two twins the night before becoming serial killers, his coworker states, "Genetics is pretty messed up." Bill then has a talk describing how the passage of time is just a mere illusion, and how we live in eternity at every moment since we experience the past, present, and future all at the same time. This thought process is to be interrupted by the news of his mother's passing. Bill looks through the remaining storage as he finds photos of himself as a child. Bill begins to feel grief as he thinks the regenerative cells that die and are reborn through the process of aging have only developed the mess he is now, and how he wishes he could be that little boy he sees in the photo again. Bill sits at the remaining belongings, picturing himself having trouble breathing and waking to a room full of concerned faces. During this moment, we see one of the most beautiful scenes, in my opinion. I'm going to quote from the script itself because I don't think I could do it justice. The narrator states he pictures himself having trouble breathing and waking to a room full of concerned faces. He'd been terrified of dying his entire life, and as much as he tried not to think about it, death was always in the back of his head, around every corner, and hovering on each horizon. He'd brushed shoulders with death on a few occasions, but in his carefree youth, it had almost seemed like an abstract, impossible thing to ever happen to him. But with each passing decade, he began to gauge the time he probably had left, and by his 40s, what he considered was his halfway point at best, he had come to know just one thing: you will only get older. The next thing you know, you're looking back instead of forward. And now, at the climax of all those years of worry, sleepless nights, and denials, Bill finally finds himself staring at death in the face, surrounded by people he no longer recognizes and feels no closer attachment to than the thousands of relatives who'd come before. And as the sun continues to set, he finally comes to realize the dumb irony in how he'd been waiting for this moment his entire life. This stupid, awkward moment of death that had invaded and distracted so many days with stress and wasted time. If only he could travel back and impart some wisdom to his younger self. If only he could at least tell the young people in this room. As Bill lifts his arm to speak, he inexplicably says, "It smells like dust and moonlight." At this moment, it is made clear that it is too late to learn from this lesson. If only he had taken time to live in the moment, to live out the dreams that his younger self wanted to achieve. Bill's dementia begins to rapidly worsen. Bill begins to forget how to perform simple tasks. He wants to have toast, but he forgets how to make it. As Bill begins to attempt his everyday life again, he begins to think everything is going better, as he then suffers from a stroke. Bill dreams of when he was a child and remembered having simple pleasures in his life. His favorite things like sunbeams, rockets, and the smell of the backyard early in the morning used to fill him with such joy. Bill eventually recovers from his condition for him to not remember where his home is. In the final chapter, we learn that Bill is assigned a new doctor. Bill doesn't recognize this hospital, but he assumes he's always lived here, as he remembers nothing before. Having difficulty recognizing faces and names, he feels his memories burn away, only becoming vague feelings. With this, Bill is not given much longer to live, as his uncle takes him in to be under family care for his remaining days. As Bill tries to make some semblance of his life, he begins taking walks around his block to end it, and then immediately do another lap as he does not remember the previous one, each time stating, "It's such a beautiful day." During these walks, he takes notes of all the beautiful things he sees, the vibrant colors of flowers, interesting texture of bricks, and glowing faces of people he passes on the street. He sees this new world that he has never experienced before, opening the childlike wonder he once knew. Pill wants to scream out to the crowd, "Isn't this amazing? Isn't everything amazing?" Pill decides to get a rental car and drive around for hours, taking in as many things as possible before he forgets them all the next morning. Pill's uncle eventually gives him an address. The address that leads Pill to his father. As Pill gets there, he arrives at a nursing home to meet an old man. As the two meet, neither of them know who each other are or why they are there, but they sit together watching TV. After some time, Pill stands up to leave as he looks this old man in the face and says something beautiful. Pill then decides to drive as far as he can, as fast as he can, until he stops in a park to lay in the grass and take in the simple beauty he finds in the sky as the world darkens around him. Pill is a simple character fighting a difficult battle. The loss of his memories, dreams, and aspirations seem to take hold and ruin him. As we can gather that Pill dies in the end, his spirit lives on. Pill will live on. He will walk the earth to learn as much as he can and experience more than any human has. Pill is the human spirit, an unrelenting force that death cannot take, for it finds the beauty in everything. The small things. The big things. Every moment is precious in our lives, and Pill is certainly no exception. Pill lived his everyday tasks that may be deemed unremarkable, but Pill lived. Pill found positives in the small things. He loved others and felt grief. And as death makes life ever so precious, there can be no love without grief. Maybe my interpretation made no sense, and I just rambled for far too long, but all I want to say is take time with life. Make time for those you love, and listen to the small things. The raindrops that hit your window. The silent moments being in the presence with someone. Whatever it may be, know that you and your life are precious. Whatever happens in your life, know that you have lived, and that's all that's important at the end of the day. And know that though death awaits us all one day, and we may never remember what happens to us in the past, it will not be the end. You will continue until the lights go out.